Thank you. The next item of business is a statement by Gillian Martin on securing a sustainable future for the Grangemouth industrial cluster. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of her statement, and therefore there should be no interventions nor interruptions. And I call on Cabinet Secretary Gillian Martin up to 10 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Chamber will be aware that Petroineos, the owner and operator of the Grangemouth refinery, has confirmed its intention to cease refining in quarter two of 2025. It's a matter of deep regret that Petroineos has not opted to continue operations at the site for longer, despite the efforts of the Scottish Government and the UK Government to urge them to do so. However, we both recognise the commercial nature of this decision. I met Petroineos CEOs on Thursday shortly after the announcement and conveyed my deep disappointment about the decision. They informed me that this decision had been taken on the basis of a viability of the refinery, informed mainly by a challenging market outlook that it and other such refineries face. Presiding Officer, firstly, I would like to pay tribute to the workforce at the refinery. They are a highly skilled workforce and have been intrinsic to Grangemouth's status as Scotland's foremost industrial concentration. And I recognise that this announcement means a most concerning time for those workers and their families, and I want to put on record my gratitude for the role that they have played in meeting Scotland's fuel needs over many decades. And let me also assure the Chamber that I have made clear to the business that regardless of the status of the refinery in 2025, it has a duty to the workers now. I expect them to be actively exploring all options to identify new roles across the Grangemouth cluster for those affected by the assets closure. I have also asked all partners of the Grangemouth Future Industries Board to do the same. Presiding Officer, I want to give my commitment that the Scottish Government will also do all that it can to support those workers. I can confirm we have enacted our PACE initiative and stand ready to offer support. On Friday, the First Minister met with workers, union representatives, Falkirk Council and community representatives to both hear firsthand their concerns regarding Petroineos' decision and reaffirm the Government's commitment to do all it can to secure a long-term future for the industrial cluster. In addition to this, members will note the Scottish Government's commitment last week to put in place a targeted skills intervention to support those impacted by the assets closure, supported by up to £500,000 of additional Scottish Government investment. And we will work closely with the business and trade unions to ensure that this meets the demands of the workforce. I also want to recognise that there are vast numbers of people in the wider community who rely on the refinery for their employment. And to this end, we will engage constructively with Falkirk Council, businesses and other stakeholders to consider all possible actions to mitigate any impact of refinery closure on the economy of the wider Falkirk area. We have also announced significant investment in the Falkirk and Grangemouth growth deal of £100 million across both Scottish and UK governments. This funding will support economic development in the area that will support securing a long-term future for the Grangemouth refinery. Members will also be aware that the Scottish Government has already provided material support to bring forward low-carbon projects, and the UK Government confirmed it would join us in supporting Petroineos' Project Willow study. Our joint £1.5 million grant is enabling Petroineos to progress the cross-site study, which will examine the enablers and blockers to transforming Grangemouth into a low-carbon fuels hub. The study will conclude early in the new year. However, it has already identified a shortlist of three credible options to begin building a long-term industry at the site, a new long-term industry at the site, including low-carbon hydrogen, clean e-fuels and sustainable aviation fuels. Presiding Officer, we have also provided £2 million to fund the initial phase of the National Gas Transmission's Feeder 10 project, which would see an existing gas pipeline between Grangemouth and St Fergus being converted so it can transport captured carbon dioxide to the Scottish cluster. This demonstrates our commitment to evacuating emissions from the Central Belt and supporting the development of the Scottish cluster. Presiding Officer, I also know many will be concerned about what this means for the future of crude oil extracted in the North Sea and transported to Grangemouth, so I want to allay those concerns. As outlined in the Scottish Government's draft energy strategy and just transition plan, Oil extracted from the North Sea is predominantly exported to international markets. The Scottish Government anticipates that this arrangement will continue and North Sea oil will continue to be refined in a number of international locations. Presiding Officer, there's no doubt that all routes to Scotland reaching net zero rely on decarbonising Grangemouth, as it is responsible for 27% of Scotland's industrial emissions. The Scottish Government has been and remains committed to securing a long-term and sustainable future for the Grangemouth industrial cluster, and our draft Grangemouth Just Transition Plan sets a clear strategic direction for the future of the industrial cluster. The plan will recognise the significant role the cluster and its workforce has played to date and the extremely important role it will play in the future, and I know that members will look forward to engaging with the draft plan in due course. It's my firm belief that there is a future for Grangemouth where the cluster can play a key part in Scotland's energy transition. However, as we have made clear before, our fiscal and regulatory autonomy in this area is limited, and therefore the Scottish Government cannot do this alone. The future of the Grangemouth industrial cluster is clearly a shared interest for both the Scottish Government and the UK Government. And I have to report I am encouraged by the UK Government's commitment to explore the possibility of supporting the future stages of low-carbon projects at Grangemouth via the National Wealth Fund. And I am committed to working with them to play our part. It will be critical in the coming weeks and months for all stakeholders to play their part to support the workforce and secure a long-term future for the site. And I call on those with a vested interest across the Chamber and beyond to work with me to secure the future for the site that aligns to our shared ambitions for the area. I have already initiated a series of engagements with key stakeholders, and my full attention over the coming weeks will be on mitigating as much of the negative impact of this decision as possible. Presiding Officer, I want to conclude by once again placing on record my thoughts are with the workforce, and I give the assurance that this Government will do all that we can to mitigate the impact of this commercial decision by Petro Ineos. I call on Petro Ineos to ensure that they handle the next phase of this process with care and respect for their workforce and the wider economy, being conscious of their responsibilities as an operator. Thank you.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions, after which we will move on to the next item of business. And I'd be grateful if members who wish to put a question were to press the request to speak buttons. And I call on Douglas Lumsden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank the Cabinet Secretary for the advance sight of her statement. This is bad news, not just for the hundreds of workers and their families directly employed by Petro Ineos, but the wider supply chain in the area. But this news is not unexpected to the devolved government. Former Cabinet Secretary Michael Matheson met with Petro Ineos as far back as February 2022 and discussed options on a just transition for Grangemouth workers. And of course, we had a statement in February this year from Mary McCallum. So the government has known that this has been coming for the last 31 months, yet it seems little has been done to prepare for the future, with the Cabinet Secretary admitting last week that Project Willow was only just starting. So can I ask, why has the Scottish Government achieved so little in the 31 months it has known that this was coming? And would the SNP Government accept responsibility that it is their narrative and their presumption against oil and gas that has got us to where we are now? They are driving away investment and driving away jobs.
Minister.
I do not accept that at all, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government and the UK Government have been a part of the Grangemouth Future Industries Board for the last 18 months. In that time, the Scottish Government has made sure that their intentions has been to support the Falkirk-Grangemouth growth deal and to put funding on the table for Project Willow at the request of Petro Ineos. But even before Project Willow, the Scottish Government provided funding to Petro Ineos to investigate their transition to a biorefinery. That is a study and a piece of work that they have been working on well before any of these decisions have been made. Now, I gently say to Douglas Lumsden that it was a bit of a sea change in July when I talked to my counterparts in the new UK Government, who actually stumped up the money to match our commitments. And I want to say that that money was never pledged by Douglas Lumsden's colleagues when they were in power. That is a matter of deep, deep regret for me, because if Project Willow had been funded by them, it potentially could have gone on, been underway a lot quicker. We are where we are. July, I got a pledge from Ed Miliband that he would match fund us not just in the Project Willow study, but in the Grangemouth-Falkirk deal, which would actually add an additional £10 million from both governments to specifically engaging in projects in the community of Grangemouth. Now, did we know that the refinery was going to close? Yes, because they told us back in November. They told us of our plans to turn it into an import terminal. Have we been working with them at pace ever since? Yes, we have. But I have to tell you that since November, being a Scottish Government representative on that, you might as well have been in your own, because there was nothing coming from the Tory UK Government at the time. Absolutely nothing.
Daniel Johnson.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of her statement, and more importantly, can I associate myself with her statement of solidarity with the workers? This is a deeply troubling time. Indeed, trade unions in recent days have expressed frustrations with both their governments, and I think given the statement that we got from Petronius, I think we need to be reflective of that frustration. So to that end, and in part she's already answered, we've heard much about the intensive engagement between both the UK and the Scottish Government in recent days and Project Willow. Could you maybe outline maybe the volume, focus and frequency of those meetings so that we can understand that every effort has been made? Can I also ask what prevented the efforts in Project Willow from being taken forward prior to the recent weeks and months? But more reflectively, for over 10 years it's been clear that something would have to happen at Grangemouth. And yet the Future Industry Board was only convened at the end of 2020. Can I ask what efforts it made to secure and look at long-term investment or investors? And could that initiative have been started earlier? Thank you.
Minister.
A number of questions in there from Daniel Johnson. I will try and remember all of them and come to them. If I maybe work back a bit, future investors. Obviously, this is a joint venture between PetroChina and Ineos. And they own the site. They operate and own the site. And any kind of investment decisions that they might have wanted to look into is for them, to be honest. We have always been clear throughout our copious meetings with Petroenios and the Grangemouth Future Industry Board that we wanted to see them maintaining the refinery for as long as possible. We wanted to interrogate the plans they had for an import terminal, but we wanted to make sure that the process of refining natural gas and oil was going to be extended for as long as possible. They were never really in the position to give us a date on when it would cease. But to be honest, when they made the decision, when they made the announcement in November, the writing was kind of on the wall and we wanted to extend it further. You asked about the frequency of meetings. So the Grangemouth Future Industries Board meets every 3 months, and obviously both governments have been involved in that, as well as a lot of stakeholders as well. But there's also been discussions that have happened with Petroenios as well to try and get a flavour of what they were going to do, when they were going to make an announcement, if they were going to make an announcement, and what that would involve. We've also had meetings with them about their import terminal proposals as well, just making sure that we were content with them. In terms of the meetings that we've had since the UK government has come in to post, I have had meetings where probably it's getting on for about one or two times a week ever since. The First Minister, when met the Prime Minister, and it was top of the agenda of their discussion the day after the general election. We have not been sitting still on this, but what has been troubling has been that, I mean, you talked about Project Willow. Could Project Willow have started? Well, Project Willow was kind of like the second tranche of the work that Petroenios has been doing. Petroenios has actually been working with funding. We've part-funded the work that they've been doing on what is needed to convert it to a biorefinery. So that had to, you know, come to fruition as well. And they have done a great deal of work in actually looking at the options there would be. They have also been putting those, the results of that study to their joint venture partners as well, because they will be taking a view on whether or not that's an investable proposal as well. Unfortunately, they have taken the decision, regrettably, the shareholders have taken a decision that they want to stop refining. But personally, I see a future for that refinery as a biorefinery. And believe you me, I am interested in anyone that comes forward with proposals to either extend the life of the refinery or to turn it into a biorefinery, whether that be Petro-Enios or anyone else.
Call Michelle Thompson to be followed by Stephen Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I've just got a short question in terms of some of the implications that could occur going forwards. Has the Cabinet Secretary explored with Petro-Enios the possibility that the shares aligned to PetroChina might be sold and thus leaving a slightly different proposition for Ineos to consider? And I'm not saying that is the case, I'm saying that all these potential options from a business perspective must be on the table, and I just wonder if she'd explored that potential with Ineos or Petro-Enios.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as Michelle Thompson will understand, when you're speaking to two organisations that are in a joint venture, there will be things that they will want to tell you, and there will be things that are commercially sensitive that they won't want to tell you. You're also in meetings where you have both parts of the joint venture in there as well. Whatever PetroChina decides to do is really a matter for them. Now, as the constituency MSP for the area, what I would recommend, and I know that Michelle Thompson has met with PetroEnios many times, is you can ask that question directly to them, because it really is something that I can't answer. Commercial decisions are being made by both partners in the joint venture surrounding this. Now, whether or not they would say, you know, what the split of shares or whatever would actually say to an elected member, or indeed would say to anyone, is really up to them. So I can't speculate on what that might mean, and I don't think that I would have a part in that whatsoever.
Stephen Kerr to be followed by Michael Matheson.
Well, I very much regret the tone of the Minister's comments about the previous government, UK government earlier, because it directly contradicts what the First Minister said at FMQs on Thursday. But can I ask the Minister, can she spell out in specific terms what practical outcomes she expects to come from the deliberations of GFIB? Will she talk about the additional £10 million from the Scottish Government? Is it new money? Will she confirm it is? What will it be spent on? And can she also then talk about how that money will be parcelled? Will it come in a one-er, or will it be over the lifetime of the city, the growth deal, which is a decade?
I should say there were several questions there. I still have many members who wish to put a question, so I'd be grateful for concise questions and responses.
If I could go through them really quite quickly. GFIB is the Grangemouth Future Industries Board that has a lot of stakeholders in it. It's not just about the refinery. I have to make that clear. They're looking at the wider Grangemouth area and the cluster as a whole. And we've got Forth Valley College in there, we've got the FSB in there, we've got Petro-Enios in there, but we've also got other companies that are in the cluster as well. So obviously the refinery will have an impact on what we talk about in GFIB very much, and it has done, but very much going forward. I want to turn to the growth deal. The growth deal, the two governments will deliver that money as a whole, £100 million, and that will be what happens with that money will be decided by Falkirk Council and their partners. They will decide how they best use that. Obviously, the work of GFIB and the discussions that we have in GFIB, I hope, will inform that. We have a very constructive relationship with Falkirk Council and the leadership there. They were one of the first people that I phoned on Thursday to talk about. Where the £10 million or £20 million, we have asked for that to be particularly kept aside for Grangemouth community. The Grangemouth community. But the growth deal is for Falkirk and Grangemouth as a whole.
Phil Matheson to be followed by Sarah Boyack.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for her statement this afternoon. I want to follow up on the issue of the growth deal, which I raised at the course of the joint ministerial meeting on Friday of last week. The Minister will be aware that the funding for the growth deal, which is now £100 million, is over a 10-year period, and there are already 11 projects within the Falkirk growth deal which come to approximately £80 million worth of projects for the whole of the Falkirk Council area. Given the impact that the closure of the refinery will have on the wider Falkirk economy, I believe there is strong merit in looking at bringing forward some of these projects to an earlier timescale than over the original 10-year period it was planned for. Can I ask whether the Cabinet Secretary, through her offices, would engage with the UK Government, given that they are joint funders of the growth deal, to look at whether they would accelerate the Falkirk growth deal to allow projects to be commissioned at an earlier stage in order to try and mitigate some of the economic challenges which we'll face in the immediate future?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, really, in a short answer, yes, absolutely. I think the suggestion is an absolutely sensible one. Now that we have got to this point where we know what's happened, the announcement was made on Thursday, then I will be having accelerated and copious meetings with my counterparts in the UK government. They also will be looking at what they can do with the wealth fund to support things. We've also put in place a skills package as well. But the point that Michael Matheson says about bringing forward these projects is something that we absolutely need to discuss, and we'll be discussing that not just with the UK Government, but we're discussing it with Falkirk Council and the members of GFIB as well.
Sarah Boyack, to be followed by Audrey Nicholl.
Can I ask what immediate difference today's statement will make, given the need for investment on site now from both the public and private investors, so that workers and communities know that their jobs will be with us this time next year? And will the Cabinet Secretary clarify how much will be invested in Forth Valley College now to get that training and skills available for people who need it now?
Cabinet Secretary.
So with regard to Forth Valley College, obviously we've made the skills offer, and we're discussing with how that's going to be delivered, not just with Forth Valley College, but also with Petrienios as well. What we're needing to get an assessment from Petrienios about is about potential skills gaps that there might be. Now, obviously, Petrienios themselves have undertaken looking at a biorefinery. We're accelerating Project Willow. A lot of that assessment about the workforce and the skills that they have will come out of both of those pieces of work, but also that's something that they have said that they will work with me and GFIB with, and actually giving an idea of the skills landscape within the current workforce. Now, whether it's skills training and skills and training is done in-house by Petrienios, whether it's done by Forth Valley College, whether it's a coming together of both those entities, is something that really is for us all to work out in GFIB as well. I'll be obviously taking my lead from Forth Valley College and Petrienios on all these matters as well. You asked what difference my statement was making today. My statement today is really an opportunity, a second opportunity for elected members in this place to ask me about what's going on. I was very pleased to spend time with not just MSPs but MPs on Friday afternoon to work through quite a lot of their questions. I think we extended our session to allow more questions to be asked. I've also sent out, if you haven't maybe had a look at your email, we've sent out some of the questions that we maybe couldn't answer just on that day, or we didn't have time to, so you have a better flavour of some of the things that we're doing in that space.
Audrey Nicholl, to be followed by Gillian Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The early authorisation of the Acorn Carbon Capture Project in Aberdeenshire would be a significant boost to efforts to find new opportunities at the Grangemouth site. So can the Cabinet Secretary provide an update on the latest engagement with the UK Government with a view to seeing or securing the approval needed?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I'm saying that I agree with Audrey Nicholl that CCUS and the acceleration into track status for the Acorn project and the wider Scottish cluster is an absolute imperative. It was very good to hear Michael Shanks say on BBC, I think he followed me directly in the Sunday show, and he was actually talking about that as a potential priority for the UK government. I'm going to be following up. We have had conversations about that. They know how important it is to get track status for the Scottish cluster. It will make a material difference to the getting carbon out of the atmosphere and out of our industries in Scotland. But it also will make a material difference in the UK's drive to net zero as well. So I'm having a lot more constructive conversations around that. I will keep the member up to date. I know that she has a particular interest in it, as do I. But things are looking a lot better in that space than they were before.
Gillian Mackay, to be followed by Claire Adamson.
the solidarity of this whole chamber should rightly be with the workers at the refinery. I'm pleased to hear that there's work ongoing to support the workers, and we should engage with unions to make sure that that support is having the desired effect. When Longannet closed, there was a similar strategy with money being invested in industry in the wider area, but very little of it made it to small local businesses who relied on the power station. What lessons have been learned from that to ensure that small businesses see the support they need, and what's being done to engage with the community around what changes they are likely to see?
Cabinet Secretary.
These are all very valid questions. Gillian Mackay will have heard me say that the Federation for Small Businesses is a core member of the Grangemouth Future Industries Board, and I am very alive to the fact that it is not just the workers in the refinery that are worried about their future. It will be the supply chain as well, and a lot of them are small to medium-sized businesses. So they are very much in my mind. We will be making sure, and that's why the growth deal is so important, because the growth deal is not necessarily just a response to the refinery closing. You know, it is a response to, we know that the impact of anything happening within that industrial site will have a much longer reach. So I am committed to making sure that we don't just concentrate on what's happening with the refinery, as important as that is, and making sure that those workers have jobs at the end of this process, making sure that as many of those workers are involved in the decommissioning process as much as possible, making sure that their redundancy packages are the way they should be, but also making sure that the wider supply chain has an in to have those discussions with myself and stakeholders, including both the UK government and the Scottish Government, and Scottish enterprise, crucially, about what this means for them and how they can access support if they need it.
Claire Adamson, to be followed by Liam MacArthur.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Apologies for my alarm going off. As someone who represents Motherwell and Wishaw, I know only too well the devastation and the impact that the deindustrialisation of my area, with no fair transition at all for the supply chain, for the workers. And I share the Minister's and the other concerns that have been raised for the workforce in the area. But I know in this situation, time is of the essence, and to secure the future industrial unit and industrial work at Grangemouth, and to secure the highly skilled workforce for that area, has to happen as quickly as possible. Does the Minister get any indication as to when some of the proposals being examined by Project Willow will be completed and information will be forthcoming?
Cabinet Secretary.
So I want Project Willow to report early next year. I don't want to wait till spring. I want it to be something that is accelerated, and I want it to be thorough, and I want it to be looking at those very questions that Claire Adamson has mentioned. As I said to Sarah Boyack, not only will this be looking at the three, in particular the three sort of like front-running strands of potential future work for the site, they will be looking at the skills assessment. Now, but there's already a great deal of work been done already on the skills assessment. I was told by Petro Ineos, I think it must have been even last summer, about the transferability of the skills of their workforce if it were to become a biorefinery. But what I'm really concerned about is that once we have alighted on potential, I am concerned that we minimise the gap between the cessation of refining in its current form and attracting that inward investment. And whether that investment comes from Petroenos themselves, whether it comes from somebody else, I want to see that gap as narrow as possible. Claire Adamson has my commitment. I come from an area that did not have a just transition as well originally. We will never do what Margaret Thatcher did. We will never do that, because we know that it lasts for decades. And you have my absolute commitment that I will make sure that Grangemouth has the full efforts of the Scottish Government, working in partnership with whoever is serious about making it, turning it into a biorefinery, a sustainable aviation hub, a hydrogen production hub, whatever will get us the maximum economic activity for those highly skilled workers who we want to retain in that area for as long as possible.
I'm keen to take those members who have pressed, but I will require more concise responses, Cabinet Secretary. I call Liam MacArthur, to be followed by Graeme Simpson.
Thank you. Like others, Scottish Liberal Democrats recognise it's an extremely worrying time for everyone connected with Grangemouth, workers, the community and businesses up and down the supply chain. It's the single biggest test of the just transition to date, with hundreds of jobs, credible skills and the vibrancy of the community at stake. The Cabinet Secretary has just referred again to the credible options in low-carbon hydrogen, e-fuels and sustainable aviation fuels. But she will recognise that with the passage of time, retaining those skills and even persuading people to remain in the area becomes ever more difficult. So can she give any more precise time frame on progress she expects to be made in those three key areas?
Cabinet Secretary.
I can't commit to a timetable because it's not just government that's involved in this. What I can tell Liam MacArthur is there's actually some other streams of work as well. Scottish Enterprise has been involved in attracting inward investment into the wider site, and they are accelerating that and focusing it on attracting inward investment and really setting out the stall. I mean, Grangemouth is geographically and infrastructurally perfectly placed to be a sustainable aviation fuel hub, to be a hydrogen production hub, to be an e-fuels hub. The infrastructure is there. The skills people are there. Anybody, any organisation that is interested in investing in something like that should be looking at Grangemouth, because it has all the component parts that are there. It is extremely competitive, a competitive option. We all speak to airlines. I'm always very interested to know what the airlines are doing in terms of sustainable aviation fuel. I was told by a representative from Heathrow that they cannot get enough sustainable aviation fuel to meet their ambitions in this area. Now, that should say to me that's a very viable proposition for someone looking to invest in Grangemouth.
Graeme Simpson, to be followed by Emma Harper.
Thank you. Well, the problem is that sustainable aviation fuel is not manufactured in Britain. We need to have it manufactured in Britain, and we should have it manufactured in Scotland for strategic reasons. And I've been saying that for a long time. The previous UK government didn't do anything near well enough on this. So what does the Cabinet Secretary think needs to happen to get SAF manufactured in Grangemouth at speed? We don't need a government report for this. We know it needs to be done.
Yeah. Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I agree with Graeme Simpson. I think that there were regulations in the reserve space that could have been modified to release the HEFA cap, for example. But one of the really interesting things that's come out of the work that Petro Ineos has done about looking at a biorefinery is that it's not just going to be a feedstock coming from vegetation that could be used for SAF. They have actually discovered that there's an awful lot more that can be used in this area. So all I'm saying is, if someone wants to create a hub for sustainable aviation fuel in Scotland, they will have our support as much as possible. And I believe that they will have the support of the UK government as well. Now, our door is open. Scottish Enterprise will be delighted to speak to anyone that's got a proposition. However, the current owners did this study and still decided to stop refining. Now, that's regrettable. Could something happen in the intervening period where Ineos make a decision that they want to turn it into a biorefinery? That's a question for them, Mr. Simpson. But this is a commercial field, but it's a commercial field that will be supported by the Scottish Government and enterprise agencies. Absolutely.
To Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary has rightly mentioned the workforce at Grangemouth in that they are highly experienced with vital transferable skills and expertise that could be used in other parts of the energy sector. Can the Cabinet Secretary reiterate or just provide further detail on how the government can support the affected workers in finding new employment?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I mentioned the skills package that we've put in place. I'm also hopeful that Petro Ineos are going to put funding into skills package as well, where we can actually augment the offer that's there. We funded a £4 million skills transition centre that's going to use state-of-the-art equipment responding to the needs of emerging sectors, like the sort of our sectors that we want to encourage to the larger Grangemouth site. But remember, there are an awful lot more pieces of of work happening in the Grangemouth site than just refining. We have chemicals production in there. I'm interested to see from Petro Ineos how many people they're going to be able to redeploy into that area of their business. We want to make sure that we attract inward investment, that we help plug any skills gap that there might be for people. The fact of the matter is, though, we're talking about highly, highly skilled people already. The biggest danger has been highlighted by a number of people, is that those people will be snapped up. They will be snapped up. We want to make sure that we minimise that gap so that they don't leave the area and we retain that skills base in the Grangemouth area.
Thank you. That concludes the ministerial statement on securing a sustainable future for the Grangemouth industrial cluster. We move to the next item of business, which is decision time. And there's one question to be put as a result of today's business. And the question is that Motion 14484, in the name of Kate Forbes, on Scottish Languages Bill at Stage 1 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. That concludes decision time, and we will now move on to members' business in the name of Audrey Nicholl.